Hey everyone, welcome to the podcast. This is Artist Decoded. I'm your host Yoshino, and you are listening to episode number 214. My guest for today is my good friend, John Wentz, who is a painter and an artist and just an all-around great person. And this was an interesting conversation because we were able to talk about his upcoming solo exhibit at Stolen Space Gallery in London, which opens on Thursday, November 4th. And I met John back in 2015 when I first started the podcast, and he was the second episode. If you like to go check it out, you should definitely not check it out because I was a terrible interviewer back then. And I don't know, just interesting how over time, when you do certain things over and over and over again, you kind of get more into a flow and you find your voice more. And I think back then, when I think about those episodes, I kind of tell people not to listen to anything past or before episode number 50. I think that's just me and my imposter syndrome coming up. And also, you know, during that time, I was learning the process of interviewing people and learning what that meant to me and what I was really interested in. And speaking of imposter syndrome, we talk about that in this podcast. I think that's just a topic that comes up a lot with a lot of different artists. We all kind of feel a certain sense of, well, maybe I shouldn't say we all feel a sense of imposter syndrome, but a lot of us as artists and creatives feel that for some reason. And we talk about the topic of NFTs, which I know is a really hot topic. But then we also talk about the future of gallery exhibitions and postulate exactly what we think is going to be happening to galleries from small to mid-tier size galleries in the future and some of John's experiences with that. But his solo show, Liminal Spaces, you know, we talk about that a lot. And there's this whole process of where he lost someone that was very close to him. And we talk about that grieving process. And John also brings up Elizabeth Kubler-Ross's work, which she touches upon the five stages of grieving. And he brought up this episode that he was listening to on Radiolab called The Queen of Dying. I personally haven't taken a look at it yet or checked it out, but we talk about the stages of grieving and how that is important to his work on Liminal Spaces. So I hope you enjoy this episode. This was a really fun exploratory conversation between me and John, and I always enjoy riffing with him. Also, before I forget, I would really like to encourage everyone that loves this podcast to go onto iTunes and leave us a solid 5-star review. It helps reviewers just like yourself to hear about this podcast, and the more the merrier. It allows for me to potentially get more sponsorship, and it would just be such a great help if you can leave a review. All right, so here it is, my conversation with my friend John Wentz. Hope you enjoy it. I know that, you know, you were spending a lot of time in Paris. When did you move to Paris anyways from the States?
I mean, it was kind of an off and on thing, but it was about like just over 4 years ago, I think.
Wow. Four years ago. That's a good chunk of time.
It's a big chunk of time. And you know, what's weird is that I came back to the States in June. Sorry, it's a little tangential thing, but just this odd thing about time. Cause like talking about it, sometimes 4 years doesn't sound like a lot. But being embedded there for that long and coming back, it was actually kind of a difficult transition being back in the States. And then especially like COVID as well there.
Yeah. What was the most difficult thing in terms of transitioning back to living in the States as opposed to being in Paris?
I think one being, because I was watching, you know, there was a turbulent 4 years for the US. So I was a spectator, you know, watching it from over the pond. And then, you know, it was nice to come back post a lot of those things, but the atmosphere had changed. So
you mean in terms of politically?
Yeah. And when I say politically, it's like running the whole gamut, you know, even it, that goes even, I think, granular to how it affects community. Cause I came straight to Oakland, which is a very community based place. So things are very politically charged, very bipartisan. I mean, I know that exists in other places, but I mean, you even look at the things about like vaccines. Of course, that happens in France, and there was a lot of protests about it. But it is so much more an issue of blue and red here, you know, Republican, Democrat, and, you know, anything else that goes along with it is very politically charged. And even down to other things, like I remember first coming back, and that's when the conversation about crypto was still heated here, because, you know, there was, I think it just started with like a BuzzFeed article, how crypto is ruining the environment. And, you know, it's not like that in Europe. And I was very excited to come back and talk about that with people. And, you know, it was like, you peed on their breakfast when you bring it up. Like, how could you talk about that? Mm. You know?
So, oh, you mean in Europe?
In here, coming here. Like, I remember going to my first show and hooking up with friends and talking to people. It was like, yeah, crypto is really exciting and this and that. And they're like, no, it's terrible. And there's no, like, I feel like there's less of a conversation here at times in the U.S. as opposed to being talked to. Mm. And so things like that, for me at least, it was my experience. And it was difficult to adjust to that.
Well, it's interesting that you say that too, because I think a lot of the times when people get defensive about their ideas, it's usually because they're insecure. I mean, at least that's what I see on an observational standpoint.
I agree. Yeah, 100%. And I think there's a lot of layers to that too.
Oh, for sure. There's a lot of nuance.
Exactly. Yeah.
It's also hard just to make statements about things. It's like, well, you know, someone does things through A, B, and C, and that's exactly why they do them. You know, there's so much nuance to the way people, like why people do certain things. And I would imagine you coming to the States and coming back to the States and wanting to talk about crypto, you know, and also you being in Oakland now, there's a lot of people that work in tech in Oakland. And so the conversation, I think, would be a lot different and colored in a different way as opposed to maybe if you had that conversation in other places.
For sure. I think that was a huge part of it and definitely something I understood and was compassionate about. But I also find, I feel like, and I think this is Americans in general, like something I experienced like there for 4 years that was really nice is my personal experience is that dialogue is more open. Like disagreements are welcomed, and I find disagreements here become combative. You know, one of my greatest like joys, like in Europe, is, you know, going to the cafes and you talk with people. If you disagree, you say, "I disagree with that. What about this?" And it's an open conversation. But I feel like the experience here is more like, "Oh, you disagree? Well, then you must be on the other side." Or, like I said, it just becomes a combative thing, and that ties into, you're right. It's like, you know, going with like cryptos or NFTs, is the tech industry is especially this part of the Bay Area, it has had a huge impact, some for good, a lot for on the negative side. So there's going to be an emotional component. It's completely understandable, but yeah, an adjustment, you know, nonetheless.
It sounds like the conversations that you had over in Europe, as opposed to the States, you can have these open dialogues about, I would assume, all sorts of different subjects, right? And what do you think is the difference between, and I mean, you know, this is kind of a generalization, right? Because, you know, there's so much nuance in conversation and, you know, people are different, but I think that there are probably cultural differences between, you know, the way people intake information in France, maybe as opposed to the way people intake information in the States. And, you know, that could come from the way people are raised over here as opposed to in Europe. But I'm curious what you observed firsthand.
Of why I think that is?
Yeah, of why you think that is.
Man, I wish I could answer that. I think it's one of those things, like you said, just taking the cultural aspect, there's so many, it's such a layered onion. I wouldn't even know how to begin. Yeah. Where do you start peeling back those layers? Because there is so many layers. Yeah. I have no idea. But it's interesting. It's really interesting.
Well, I guess just from an observational standpoint, then, did you enjoy the act of diving into different subjects in France as opposed to coming back to the States?
Yeah, absolutely. Because for me, just me personally, I think I'm kind of a contrarian by nature, and I learn and change my mind by being devil's advocate, or I just love being, or being opposed. Like, I like having views opposed, you know, it forces you to look from different perspectives. So having that openness there was a lot of growth, like personal growth for me. But I think that's changing here. You know, for instance, just, you know, you look at the subject of NFTs, in particular in Oakland, now there's a whole like movement of like NFT artists. Like, the dialogue changed within just a couple of months. I don't understand exactly why, but it is changing.
What do you see the dialogue being now when you have conversations with artists about NFTs?
You know, what's funny is in a group, it's still very dubious and speculative, but one-on-one, when you talk to people, they love it and want to know more about it because it's a new avenue, new opportunity for artists, you know, and that's within the group of people I know. But I see, like, even, I think it's tonight. Yeah, tonight, somewhere in Oakland, there's an NFT event, like at the Oakland Tribune, a group of muralists, I guess, are dropping NFTs on Maker's Place or something. So now they're actually turning it into community events.
So then, I mean, have you been to any of these events?
No, I haven't. I haven't gone that much.
Are you gonna be going to this event?
No, I have to pack for my trip. I'm leaving Sunday, which I would like to go because I want to see why and how, you know, the conversation has changed. But it, you know, it's going to grow here. So if and when I come back, it's something I'll definitely check out. But the summer, as soon as I got back, it was just extremely busy. And so I went to a couple of art openings just because I wanted to experience that again. But I haven't been able to do much outside of that.
It's kind of a ample time, too, to get into NFTs as well, because over the course of the past couple of years, I mean, I think it might have sprung on because of the pandemic, but it seems like you've been doing a lot more digital works as opposed to strictly oil paintings. Is that correct?
Yeah, definitely. And that was strictly because of the pandemic when I was in Paris. Like, I started doing in, I think it was like 2018. Is when I found, like, I upgraded an iPad. You know, there was a lot of talk about Procreate, so I wanted to check that out. And it was, for me, like, instantaneous, like, love. I think it's amazing. But, you know, it's interesting. I get very excited about it, or got very excited about it. But then talking with gallerists and other people, like, literally, it was like, quit playing with it. It's a toy. You know, there's never going to be anything you could do with this outside of, like, you know, you can do an actual print run, you know, and that was prior to NFTs. But I found too that, at least my experience, maybe because I wasn't known as a, and am not known as a digital artist, the print runs weren't as great as like doing an oil painting. And then I did it, just leave it as something for the side, or I've used it a lot for doing like studies for paintings. But then, when we went into lockdown, my studio space closed. So then it was either do digital or nothing. So I did a thing where I was doing one artwork per day. You know, I think a lot of people were doing that. And so it was really like a deep dive into the digital world. And I mean, honestly, I mean, I can't say I prefer it, but it's a very, very exciting avenue. And especially now you see a lot of artists using AI, mixing that with oil paintings, or just their digital work they do on a separate program. So it's really expanding quickly.
AI with oil paintings. So have you seen that happening? Have you tried to experiment with that?
I haven't yet. It's funny. I was just talking on WhatsApp with Dan Nopin. And I think, Dan on the podcast. Yeah.
I love Dan. Yeah. He's a nice guy.
He's an amazing guy.
And I think he brought you up on the podcast.
Oh, did he? Okay.
I think so.
Now I'm paying it back.
yeah, exactly.
There you go, Danimal. It's for you. he's just getting into it as well. And but I mean, I haven't been able to even dip my toe in it yet. But I'm just watching what people do, and it seems very interesting.
I messed around a little bit with that using AI programs and integrating it into the photography.
Okay.
But nothing extensive. I was just,
how do you like that? With it.
I mean, I like the idea of randomly generating things and kind of curating it later.
Right.
I like that idea, or just, I don't know. I like the idea of experimenting with different types of mediums and seeing what comes out on the other end, because at the end of the day, it's just your brain. Well, I mean, with artificial intelligence, it's, you know, utilizing an AI program, but I think the idea of just, you know, at the end of the day, with being an artist, you have to curate your own work. Uh-huh. And you have all these mediums, whether it's writing or music or photography or oil painting or whatever, you know. And I think like getting stuck in a particular medium is a little bit short-sighted.
Sure.
But that's just my perspective. Although I know that, you know, there's a lot of nuance in oil painting specifically, if we're, you know, just using that as an example. And you can dive into that exponentially. But for me as a creator, I just like to experiment, and it makes the idea of experimentation more fun. So I don't know. And I think like, I don't know, sometimes doing things for monetary purposes can really take away from the fun aspect of wanting to do something just for the fuck of it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Oh, fully. Totally agree. I think, yeah, that's a quandary I hear more and more with artists.
Yeah.
Especially if this is your bread and butter is making your art, then it becomes difficult time-wise. It becomes difficult, I think, even on a level of creativity. You know, is there any point in doing this?
Yeah. Do you ever feel imposter syndrome?
Oh, man. That word is, or words have come up a lot lately. And yes, absolutely. I do.
Yeah.
And I see a lot, you know, I spend more time on Twitter now, and I see a lot of people talking about that.
Hmm. Yeah.
How about you?
Oh yeah, for sure. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I've been a photographer for so long, and sometimes I'm just like, am I really a photographer? You know what I mean? Like, yeah. I'm just like, am I even good at this? You know, like, does it matter if I'm good at this? Do I like it anymore? I don't know. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, there's that sort of like endless spiral of things that you tell yourself. And then at the end of the day is like, is that necessary? I don't know. Maybe it is. Maybe, I don't know.
Well, something I wonder about that, like, and I'm sure again, with, there's a lot of nuance to imposter syndrome, but because I feel that a lot, and I notice with myself, it's kind of in periodically. And I wonder if that's also when you're kind of like on that precipice of change or discovery with your work, because it's kind of a point of vulnerability. And in order, I think, to do that change, you have to question a lot of yourself and maybe your past work. You know what I mean? It's like kind of outgrowing it. Like, you look at what you're doing, you're like you're saying, it's like, am I even good at this? Is there any point to this? You know, am I just rehashing the same old thing? Oh, I'm just an imposter. But maybe that's because you're finally getting a fresh view, and it's that point of like moving forward and growing.
No, totally. Yeah. And, you know, that kind of reminds me of this book that I've been listening to recently by Brene Brown called Dare to Lead. Are you familiar with Brene Brown?
No, I'm not. I'm not.
A lot of her work is within the space of vulnerability specifically. And, you know, she does a bunch of like TED Talks and, you know, different, she has her own podcasts and books and those sort of things. But she says that in order to have courage, you have to be vulnerable. And I don't know, something about that in particular really struck me, just because I think it's easy to be confident when you're like in the flow of certain things.
But, sure.
But I think in order to have growth, you have to have the courage to be vulnerable, right? And to be open. And I don't know. Yeah, it's just, you know, I think about that in terms of the change of tides or seasons changing. I think about that a lot with moving on to the next chapter of life. And sometimes you kind of have to like sift through the mud for a couple months or longer, or a whole year, to just kind of find that diamond in the rough.
Right. Yeah, no, I totally agree with that. And I wonder too if that's, you know, a lot of that talk is happening now. Sorry, I've said post-COVID like 5 times since we started, but
no, it's okay. I mean, let's be fair. COVID was a really a huge turning point for everyone. So,
yeah, I also realize it feels like people are tired of talking about it, you know. And sometimes I'm tired of hearing about it. It just depends on the mood, you know. You want to move forward.
Totally understand. Totally.
But I do think that triggered that in a lot of people. You know, it's like there was so much it's time for self-reflection and things like that, and opening avenues of vulnerability. That a lot of people are feeling that.
Yeah. No. Definitely. I mean, it's easy in certain ways to be carried by inertia. So if everything's going right and you're constantly just, you know, or you're feeling good, you know, you're constantly getting these dopamine highs and everything, but to be able to take that time and it's like forced upon you by COVID and you're suddenly stuck at home. I think for artists, it's a different story because generally artists, depending on what medium you do, but you're usually by yourself, right? So, but I think a lot more people, maybe working like a traditional 9-to-5 when you go in to an office and they're suddenly stuck at home, a lot of the things that they could potentially escape by going to into an office setting and working for a company, they actually have to face, whether it's, you know, dealing more with your partner, you know, there's certain things that aren't dealt with, or, you know, there's a lot of things that you're confronted with, right? So... Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, I was going to say, which could lead to a potential existential crisis.
Yeah, and happened a lot. And I, you know, since I've been here, somehow I find myself connecting with a lot of people working at Google. And so the stories I hear were exactly like that. A lot of people, because they're working remotely, moved to more rural areas. You know, there was this forced reevaluation of their life and their lifestyle. What are they doing this for? And this stuff I heard secondhand. But, you know, in the topic of artists too, I mean, definitely I don't want to say it was easier or better, but you're right in that it doesn't affect your working methods. But I feel like it's still, you know, with people I've talked to and things I saw online, it did affect in the way that your sole output for your work was even more so social media. And at that time, because, you know, it was so... social media, especially like Instagram, was like the influx was huge, exponential, you know, prior to COVID, that algorithms affected things. So even artists were going into some kind of existential crisis because of that. Like, no one's seeing my work. I'm putting more time in, you know, things like that. Why are the likes less, or, you know, this and that. Some people thrived, some people didn't.
What was your experience with that?
It was actually really good. I kind of wish we could go back to lockdown. It was kind of nice. It was this.
Wait, in what aspects?
There's the one like we're talking about. Like, I love being alone anyways, so it really didn't affect me that much for a bit. It did later on, but forced to explore digital more, and then like I started selling digital works prior to NFTs. It was just doing it through commissions and DMs. And then I got some digital work, like freelance work. I did a project with Procreate. And it was through Graffiti Art Magazine. It was a watch company or something like that. So I actually got freelance work. And so that was how I also maintained myself through the pandemic, was just doing digital work.
Yeah. So I'm curious. I mean, you know, NFTs are coming up a lot in this conversation. And what have your experiences been with NFTs?
So I just started recently. Not even 2 months, I think. And
so you're an expert is what you're saying.
Yes. I'm the person to talk to right now.
Yeah.
So everybody take notes. Yeah. Do not listen to me. This is a very... I shouldn't even be talking about this.
No. I mean, you can learn a lot in 2 months, man. I was just messing with you. I mean, NFTs it's a really interesting topic. Like, I'm super curious about them, and, you know, so.
I think they're fantastic. You know, like, I was going to jump on early on. So part of what happened to me, so I left Paris in January, February. And went to the Netherlands because the lockdowns were getting crazy. We're in, we're out. And the Netherlands was a little bit more relaxed, I guess you would say. And so there I was with, you know, Dan, and have you talked to Daniel Martin? I think you, maybe you've had him on the podcast.
Yeah, I had him on the podcast. I haven't talked to him for a couple of years now, but I like Daniel. Yeah.
But you know, yeah, Daniel's great. We started talking about it there, but I wasn't ready to jump into it. So Daniel got back to me over the summer and just kind of is like a push, you know, you should really try this out because you've been doing all this digital work. So I decided to start on I don't want to say lesser platform, but a smaller platform, or it was then, which was Hicketnunk. check the pronunciation. which runs on the Tezos blockchain. And you can do additions on there. The minting is next to nothing. So it was a good gateway for me because, you know, Super Rare is curated. And, you know, I have an account on Foundation, but the gas fees for Ethereum are always just too high or up and down. And I don't have the energy to go into that. So I started doing the NFTs on Hicketnunk. And it's been amazing so far. You know, one aspect, and I think artists are starting to embrace this, is the monetary side, like being able to make money without a middle person in there. But also, you know, something specifically I liked about Hicketnunk is it's very community-based. On Twitter, it's all connecting with people, supporting people. And I really liked that aspect. And I think that's probably what drew me into it more because – and especially, again, like going back to lockdown and just being an artist in general, you know, it's like a lot of solitary time. And I feel, for me personally, it's so much effort being put into promoting or getting your stuff out there that it feels less community-based. You know, I always feel like I'm just trying to do things for myself. So working with other people and seeing other work and meeting new artists really appealed to me.
And is the community conversations, are those more so on Twitter, or do you have specific Discord groups that you contribute to?
Yeah, so I would say, at least for me, I know everybody, I mean, there's so many Discord groups and this and that. I'm on like 3 or 4 Discord groups that are really supportive. And then that's probably 25%. And then 75% of it just takes place on Twitter. Which is hilarious because I think I used Twitter once a month before that, and now I'm on Twitter all the time.
Yeah, I never use Twitter.
Twitter's great. I love it. I hardly use Instagram anymore.
Interesting. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I mean, maybe, you know, if I go more into the NFTs, then it'll incentivize me a bit, but.
It seems to be the case. But, you know, it's weird. I don't know if you noticed this. It was like the thing that happened. Like, so with the NFT explosion, you know, it was back in what, like April, there was this wedge that went between the two platforms. And I remember watching people posting their NFT on Instagram, and then everybody came out with their torches and pitchforks, you know, and you'd lose followers and people were panicking. But on Twitter,
do you mean because of the ecological ramifications of?
Yeah. Because it literally was, like, at least to my experience, it was like a BuzzFeed article that went viral, and it was full of misinformation. And then other.
Well, I only get my news from BuzzFeed, so.
Well, it seemed like everyone else did. But what I was just about to say, though, is like then other outlets picked up that ball and ran with it, you know. And I'm not saying it's not true. You know, when people are talking about the mining and the impact, it's like, yes, it does have an impact. But there's a more nuanced conversation to be had here. But it was all broad brushstrokes. So there was just this wedge where people stopped doing that on Instagram and it went solely to Twitter. So I feel like, I mean, I'm seeing it more on Instagram now. I guess it's okay now to come to talk about your NFTs on Instagram. But I feel like, you know, moving forward in the future, like Instagram is going to be more of your portfolio social media.
Yeah.
And Twitter is like that real time conversation. And I think at first with the NFTs, for whatever reason, again, I'm a newbie at all this, Twitter is more tech based. And So I think that's why there was a greater conversation to be had there. But also in terms of monetization, you know, it's all real time on Twitter and it's easy to do. You post a link, everybody sees it. And that's something Instagram doesn't really have. Mm. It's less conversational, more just, hey, here's my work and portfolio.
Yeah. Yeah. If anything, I mean, Instagram, when you post links like through your caption, you can't actually click the link. So then you always have to redirect people to, I guess, your page, you know, your bio or something to be able to access like a link. And then generally what people do, I think, is use like something like Linktree so that they can have multiple links.
See, I use Linktree. And it's just like the age we're in, right? It's like you have to make those things as easy as possible. Yeah. So if you're redirecting somebody to your bio, it's like, it's too much work for my thumb. I need to save a click and they won't do it. And then, you know, in stories, they recently changed that swipe up feature. And I don't think a lot of people know this. It took me a while to figure out. It's like you have to do it through a sticker and it's just a hassle.
Yeah. You know what? I wonder in like a couple of years how this conversation is going to age.
I'll do it a couple of months. What are you talking about?
Yeah, just a couple of months. Yeah.
So I'm hesitant to talk about this stuff. It's going to be totally different.
I know. That's also, you know, we kind of have to embrace that when we talk about technological things, technology changes so quickly nowadays that, I mean, there was like CryptoKitties, you know, a couple of years ago, but NFTs, you know, is a relatively new conversation for a mass audience of people. And there's a lot of nuance in that. And,
totally. It's like the Kurzweil thing, right? It's like it is exponential. Mm-hmm. It changes so rapidly. So yeah, by December this conversation will be outdated.
Yeah. No, definitely. Okay, so going back to your show, Liminal Spaces, which is at Stolen Space Gallery in London.
Correct.
So I want to know what sort of things you've been through that made you want to entitle it Liminal Spaces, and you know what that means on like a spiritual front, but then also what that means, like, I guess, what sort of new work have you been working on and that you're presenting in this show?
Okay, I'll go, I guess, like to the backstory, because there's kind of a backstory behind it. But the another nice thing I think about the lockdown and not being able to paint oil painting wise is, for me, it was like a lot of time to reflect on what I've been doing, how I wanted to move forward in the future, you know, as a painter. And then I think even just like what, you know, it's, I hope this doesn't sound like pretentious, but like what painting means to me or what art making means to me. And so at the time, during lockdown, not being able to paint, I was still thinking a lot about painting. But also, I had a situation where somebody very, very close to me passed away unexpectedly. And that was literally right when you couldn't even fly out of Paris. Like, it was that brief moment when the airports were shut down. So I was, in effect, stuck in Paris and couldn't come back here. Mm-hmm. And then there was nothing to do. Like, it was still with the essentials were open. So it was like grocery stores. And then churches, basically. And so I found myself just going to the churches a lot. It was something to do. And I've never been one for like religious artwork. I mean, I was raised Catholic, but never even considered myself spiritual. But I just went there. They're beautiful. I mean, it's different than here. You know, hundreds of years old, I could go to these different cathedrals. They had the most amazing artworks in there.
Yeah.
And I would do that for hours a day. And I think this thing just kind of happened, like looking at the artwork, watching other people come in, and like I would go and sit in the back and just watch people and watching people come in and praying or whatever, you know, looking for something bigger than themselves. And it kind of became this transformative thing for me, you know, this idea of, I don't want to say like a God or anything like that, but something bigger than yourself. Not only that experience, but the necessity of it. You know, I've always been quite atheistic, and it just really kind of hit me heavily that that's kind of part and parcel to our experience, you know, the human experience, the human condition, I feel that necessity for something bigger than yourself. And in seeing those artworks in there as well, it sounds dumb to say like a kinship, but you feel like you understand what the artists were striving for, and it was just that, like something bigger than themselves. And I remember, I can't remember the exact cathedral, but they had all these frescoes in there and murals, and there was particularly one that still I reference and is at the moment like my favorite painting in the world, because it was completely deteriorated. Like the color had washed off because, you know, it was probably, I don't know what era, but there was a full grisaille underneath and the color had completely disappeared. And then even the actual painting was tearing apart. And it actually reminded me quite a bit of, do you know the painter Nicholas
Amoria?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, the way you were describing it, I was like, oh,
it's like just like it. Yeah. To the point where I was like, either that is his or he saw this painting, you know, because it looked exactly like, but to see it in the flesh and knowing the age of it and stuff like that, it was just really impactful.
Yeah,
to me, on many levels, like the ephemeral quality of art, like we think these things are going to last forever. And then being in a church, you know, seeing what people are doing, it's like they're accepting their mortality, or they're, you know, looking for some kind of change or for some hope or something like that. And so I just continued to do this. And it was, a few months later that idea of that transition, like not just with loss, but with anything going, it could be good or be bad. Let me take a step back. And also, like at the same time, I was rereading the Tibetan Book of the Dead, which I've read a few times before. And I found it interesting, the cross section between those two experiences. And then one being, you know, of a Western philosophy and one of an Eastern philosophy. And there was a lot of disparate elements. And then there was a lot of elements that I think coincided. Go ahead.
Oh, no, I was going to say, I'm sure by comparing the two different types of ideologies from the Western perspective and the Eastern perspective in that context that you were talking about, that you can probably see a lot more overlap and similarities than differences. Is that correct?
Yes, probably. Yeah. In the more granular ones, I think there was more overlap. I think what was interesting is the greater differences were the end point. Because even, you know, to my understanding, like I actually used to consider myself Buddhist. I used to go to Buddhist churches a lot in practice. And depending on what tradition, like a lot of Buddhists will take that metaphorically. Now I do know, like, you know, the actual Tibetan monks who will recite the passages and go through the ritual of the dead, they take it very literally, but for the most part, people will take it metaphorically, Buddhists. Not so in the Western tradition, right? It's a very literal thing. There is a heaven. You will transcend to that if you do good, yada, yada, yada. But also, the difference that was the most fascinating to me is the Tibetan Book of the Dead is a literal map. It's a guidebook to get you to that point. Whereas in the Western tradition, there's really not, except for like 10 commandments. And then we all know you can cherry pick those things. you go through Leviticus and Deuteronomy, then there's opens up a whole nother can of worms. But that had the biggest impact for me. And that's what got me into the idea of the importance of the liminal space, that transitional space, because I think that is the greatest overlap for me, is they're both dealing with a transition in different ways and in different descriptions. The beautiful thing with the Tibetan Book of the Dead, and it is beautifully illustrated in the film Enter the Void. Have you ever seen that with Gaspar Noé?
I've seen parts of that film, actually, but I haven't seen the entirety of it. I think I've seen like the first act where I think the main character goes through a drug overdose, right? And then it turns into this sort of like out of body experience. Is that correct?
Exactly. Yeah. And that's exactly what you read through the Tibetan Book of the Dead. And I think what he did, like the most beautiful aspect to capture it is like setting it, I think it was in Tokyo, right? It's mm-hmm. been a little while since I
watched it. I think it is in Tokyo. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that was very specific because in the Tibetan Book of the Dead, it's all described in colors and light. So he utilized the neon of the city. Hmm. And if you can almost read that book as you're watching the movie, it's really amazing. I think it's a beautiful contemporary adaptation.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
I saw Gaspar Noé at, I think he was giving a discussion in LA somewhere, but he didn't talk about Enter the Void. He was talking a lot about the juxtaposition between dissonant elements and like happy, sort of like more or seemingly happy, like music, for instance, like ultra violent things juxtaposed with like happy music, for instance. I don't know. He's a strange dude. He's a very strange dude.
That makes some very strange films. Some I like, some not so much. But for me, Enter the Void is the masterpiece that he created.
Yeah.
And I think too, I tried rewatching it recently, but I had too much going on. But it was another thing that solidified just this interest for me in transitional states, you know. And that is such a broad term because I think it, you know, liminal space has been used in like an architectural term, like a hallway is literally a liminal space. But then you see it in spirituality, psychology, you know, rituals completely deal with that. You know, you look at something like a funeral, right? That moment in between you're transitioning, you know, from pre having a life with this person and then post to having a life with this person. And what does that mean to you?
Yeah. And also how instantaneous that could be. I mean, depending on how the person passes away and then how that sort of liminal space will now exist in the people that surround that person as well. And, you know, each person has their own grieving period depending on how close they are to that person. And, I don't know. There's a lot to be learned about oneself through that in-between period. And from my understanding of what you're describing in a liminal space, it's kind of like a changing of tide or the change of seasons.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And then who knows how long that lasts for, you know, you have that space within the ritual, but again, like losing somebody very close to you, it could be a matter of years. It's a very slow change and a very impactful change.
Yeah.
But going back to the paintings, what interested me and what I was doing and hope to continue, because it's so interesting to me, is taking that experience of being in the cathedrals and taking a lot of like the iconography, the Western iconography. There's something about, you know, I always found those things so static. You know, you look at Renaissance art, you know, or I remember the first time like going to Italy. And every painting's Madonna col Bambino. You know, it's just that because the religious art was so prevalent there. It's all Madonna and child. And after a while, you're
in Italy specifically?
I was in Porto of Umbria. I've been in Venice. All over the place. But especially, I remember seeing a lot of that in Venice. Which was the most refreshing was seeing Titian, because Titian became like the compositional master. He just kind of broke the mold and made things more interesting, incorporated a lot of more interesting geometry.
Yeah.
But there is something, you know, another, I think, overlap with the artwork between the East and the West is the utilization of those few poses. Like, you know, you look at something like a Tibetan artwork, it's very, very symmetrical. And it's done over and over and over again. It's because the intent is for it to be meditative and not to be over. I mean, you know, that changes because then you could automatically go to the argument of Michelangelo, but that was in the transition. But prior to that, I think it was very much a meditative quality to those static poses. So I started pooling from some of those, like in the churches, I was just doing quick sketches of the paintings I was seeing and stuff like that.
It's interesting because it sounds like there's liminal spaces within liminal spaces.
It's a rabbit hole, man.
It is.
No, there really is. And I think that's kind of what's interesting about it. You know, another one of the many things that's interesting about it. It requires a lot, not only requires, but initiates a lot of self-reflection.
So do you think right now at this particular point in your life, you are in a liminal space or you're in a point of transition?
For sure. I mean, it's been just over a year for me losing this person, and I'm learning, you know, there's no time on that. You want there to be. That's my experience. Like, you know, we have these arbitrary landmarks, or hallmarks, you know, of things like anniversaries and birthdays, right? And that we equate like getting older. My birthday, I'm this old, I should be doing this. There's this baggage that comes with it. And, you know, the first year of going through losing somebody, it's like the 1 month anniversary, this two, you know, so on and so forth. And I think my experience is you come with this idea of like, oh, that means it's going to get easier, but it's actually can be the opposite, or it's more of a roller coaster. So, and then, you know, I've done a lot of reading, you know, outside of this stuff, you know, researching grief and listening to podcasts. That seems to be the thing, is there, it can be 1 year for some, it can be 10 years for others, or some people don't get over these things.
Do you have any good recommendations for podcasts or books on grieving?
So I'll get the podcast and then maybe you can link it. But there, I did listen to something about Elizabeth Kubler-Ross that was really fascinating. And she's kind of credited with the stages of grieving, which is, which was interesting because I found out that's also, it's not anything that's substantiated. Like it's become, I don't know the right word for it right now, but a lot of people buy into these stages and that, you know, you experience these stages sequentially and whatnot, but it's not the case. But I found her story interesting because it started with giving a voice to people who were dying. And generally most of them were terminally ill because in the, back then, I think, I don't know, it was like the 70s. It started earlier, like in the 50s, but people who were terminally ill were kept away and out of sight in hospitals because, you know, there's certain things about funding and then just what they thought about the psychology of other people seeing that. And she was the first to come in and want to interview these people and give them a voice. And in turn, that became, she was finding, is like discourse is the best for not just the dead and dying, but also for the living.
Discourse in which way?
First hearing them. It's like, what is their experience? Like, what can we learn from these people who are facing imminent death? And then for the people, the loved ones who are going to have to experience that, being able to vocalize it. Because that was also something, you know, you went to a funeral, you did your Hail Marys or whatever it is, and then it's done. But we don't work like that. So talking about it, being open about this, the discussion of grieving. Go ahead.
Oh, no, I was going to tie that back in with, you know, what we were talking about earlier with Brené Brown and, you know, having the courage to be vulnerable, right, in that situation and being able
100%.
To open up and talk about it with hopefully people that you feel safe with talking about that, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's perfect. That's what it was. It's vulnerability on both sides. And her story is interesting. People can listen to it, but it was what I found really interesting is towards the end, if I remember correctly, she herself had problems with herself dying. And that on one end, you know, to a lot of people spoke to like, well, then your work is, you know, terrible. It shows there's no validity in it. But I think for me, what that shows is just how impactful it is facing your own and also dealing with people who have passed.
You mean the fear of dying for her?
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. Mm. Because her whole, you know, I guess it's a thesis as you would have it is, you know, that talking about these things and being open is going to be the solvent for it. Like this is the solution. And in fact, it wasn't. It's another coping mechanism. I don't even want to say it's a coping mechanism. I mean, this is out of my wheelhouse of knowledge, but
it's more of like an intellectualization of the instance of death.
Exactly. And there was this thought that it would cure it or, you know, have this substantial effect of helping with it. And it did for some, but then in facing her own, it was the opposite. Having experienced someone very close to me passing, it's like, there are no words you can put to it. And so I can only imagine what facing your own is like. And that, so it spoke to the gravity to me of facing your own.
Yeah. You know, speaking to this idea of death, I was watching this YouTube video, and I think you can find it just if you type in like 96-year-old philosopher talking about death or something to that effect. Mm-hmm. But it's this man that was a philosophy professor, and he had multiple books on various subjects. One was about talking about death and the significance of death and dealing with death. And he was talking about, you know, how at that time when he made that book, he thought he solved the issue, right? You know, he solved this idea of dying, the bookend of life, right? But then as he was there, 96 years old, you know, pretty close to his own death, you know, he said that, you know, he actually still would like to live, you know, and how the things that he thought he solved in that book, he actually didn't solve at all. And I felt like that was a very vulnerable thing to say, because I think we're living in a culture, especially in Western culture, where we have to have these answers and we're always trying to over-intellectualize and seek answers. But sometimes things are so nuanced that it's unanswerable. And I don't know, I just thought, found that to be really fascinating.
That's pretty amazing. Yeah, no, you're right. I think it is very vulnerable to be able to admit that.
Yeah, and especially because if you're essentially as a philosopher and a philosophy professor, you know, it's, you're constantly trying to, well, I don't know. I'm not a philosophy professor. I'm like trying to, hey, here's me over Here's me trying to over intellectualize things. But I think something, you know, when we were talking about this, Kubler-Ross, the grieving cycle, I brought it up on my computer and I just want to tell people the different stages. So the first is denial. The second is anger. The third is bargaining. The fourth is depression. And then the final one is acceptance. So in this podcast, were you saying that Kubler-Ross, like this idea has changed over the course of time, or?
Yeah. So again, to my understanding, not speaking as an expert, of course.
I mean, we're both artists, you know, so.
what do we know? Experts.
yeah. Artists always over-intellectualize.
Yeah. No. No, so to my understanding, this was her experience, and it is very true. These things do exist, but I think it, as it got into like the cultural vernacular, it became like stepping stones, and that was aside from her. That wasn't something she pushed forward, and maybe not even with experts. Because I mean, I don't know about you, but I always heard that in just like common dialogue. You know, it's the same thing, you know, like the telephone game, how we talk about things and all of a sudden they become these concrete things, is that now people would talk about the stages of death. Oh, well, you must be in this stage. And it became, like I said, like a sequential experience. And that by the end, when you reach acceptance, you know, after you experience these others. And so what I've read as of recent is they've done more studies on this, that no, that's not the case at all. They can come in any order, and they go back and forth as well. You can, and again, in my experience, I'm sure anyone else who's had this experience, is, you know, one day you feel depression, but then you'll go back to bargaining, and then you go back to anger, and these can flip on a dime. You can sit with it for weeks. There's no order to this, and it's not a walkthrough to where you finally hit acceptance. Mm-hmm. But again, that's not the theory she was pushing forward. That's just kind of what it evolved into.
Definitely. Yeah.
That was her observations.
Yeah. I think something that we also have to keep in mind too about these ideologies is like, sometimes people are just trying to sell you an idea. I mean, I'm not, you know, sure about the context of, you know, how these ideas came about and all that, but it's just living within a society that is highly profited by people's insecurities about not knowing the answers to certain subjects, we have to be conscious of who is selling the idea to us. And whether that is like the news media on, you know, certain things with NFTs or just, I don't know. There's a lot of like bureaucracy and politics that kind of get intermingled with the selling of ideas.
Yeah. And nice callback to NFTs, man. That was,
well,
that was good.
I don't know. Finding
that through line.
Aren't we all? I mean, maybe not everyone is. I don't know. I
agree with you. I 100% agree with you. I think that is really important. But also, I think too, my experience with the danger—not I don't want to say danger of it, but I'll use the term just for lack of a better term.
Sure.
Is that it's also one of those things that you want an answer for so bad, right? I mean, that's how religion has become so concrete, because the death at the end of the day, it's the greatest mystery. And like they say, death and taxes, man, that's the only two things we're assured in life. So we want an answer for sure, 100%. But also taking a step back in the grieving process, is this going to end? Like, that's the constant question, is when does the pain stop? When do I stop missing? When do I accept? So if somebody can sell you that idea of like, well, here's your stages, you know, just keep walking this path and you'll land there.
Yeah.
It's very enticing, but it's just not how it works.
Yeah.
And I think that leads me what I started seeing is like the importance of ritual outside of these paths, like the stages of grieving or, you know, or even going to, some people go to psychics to get relief, you know, these type of things. Ritual is, I think, the best thing we have to find some kind of acceptance with it. Because something and forgive me, because I didn't really know how much I was going to want to talk about any of this.
Sure.
But
talk as freely as you'd like, you know, or, you know.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Another part of the experience is we weren't allowed to have a funeral because it was during COVID. And that really, for me, and going back to even like, have you read much like Joseph Campbell?
A little bit. I'm more so familiar with his interviews.
Okay. And take him for what he is. I know everyone's a controversial figure.
Yeah.
But he's
a great contributor of ideas to be able to, you know, talk about the hero's journey and those sort of things.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And more so, and I know a lot of his topics on mythology are widely debated, but I find more his research on ritual to be more interesting and the importance of it. And so looking at even just having, you know, like what is a service, a funeral service? It's a communal grieving and a communal acceptance and experience of a person's life. On the surface, doesn't seem like much, but having gone through a situation where being not allowed to experience that, my personal experience is it's a huge thing to have. It leads you towards, I don't know if closure is the right word, but maybe towards that idea of acceptance. So I feel that loss of not being able to have and partake in that ritual.
Yeah. I could imagine. I mean, and it's interesting too, that you didn't use the word closure, because I think that when you have such a loss in your life, it's not exactly like there's a specific instance that can give you that closure, right? It's these.
Well, nor do you want it.
Yeah.
And I think that's, you know, what's an appealing. There's two sides to the thing, like an afterlife, that I think is appealing to people. Is one, it's not lights out for me when I go, so at least I know I continue somehow. But also, it's that idea of like, you can accept that absence without having closure. They are somewhere else. It's not like they are gone. They are somewhere else. And that's there's a chasm between those two things.
Yeah. I'm curious about this idea of ritual. So what sort of things have you found to help you along the process of grieving?
The first was painting, like doing these works. Like I'm not going to say like anything was like specifically about, you know, a certain person, but it the whole process, not just making the painting, but the process of art making was, because there was the research, the reading, self-reflection. I think those are all things that kind of happen within a ritual, you know, some of them at least. That was very helpful to me. Wait, were you saying just about the work?
I mean, just in general, about ritual in general, you know, what?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, what sort of rituals are, because when you say ritual, I think of things as habits almost, but maybe I'm misinterpreting that a bit.
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely, I think, one aspect of it is habits. Or maybe that's just a colloquialism now, but a ritual can really be anything. Like for instance, something I plan to do is, you know, I'm leaving for Europe on Sunday and I'm going to be going to different countries. And this person really wanted to travel Europe and never had the opportunity. So I'm bringing items with me and I'm going to go to specific places and bury them there. That's a form of ritual.
Oh, I see.
You know, I think a ritual, like, I guess from like a Campbell's perspective, it's an act that puts you into a certain state of mind. So it's not just your habits. So you look like any, like a birthday is a ritual, right? You walk into that ritual beforehand. One person, if it's your birthday, you go through this thing of being said happy birthday, you receive gifts, you're celebrated, yeah. And you walk out a year older. You know, that's a ritual. And, mass, you know, that's another thing, like going back to when, you know, I was in watching these cathedrals, like I was raised religious. It never had a huge impact on me, really, except for a lot of vestigial guilt that I have to deal with now.
Yeah, I understand that. Yeah.
But, why, you know, as an observer, that it was more interesting as opposed to somebody partaking. Like I was watching people come in during this like really trying time and receiving mass and then praying for like an hour on end. And the looks on their face leaving was a very different thing. So you walk into that space, one person, you go through this ritual, you walk out a different person or with a different experience.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's interesting. Yeah. I mean, I'll have to look more into Joseph Campbell and how he expounds upon that idea of ritual, but something that I've always found, or not always, but in the past year or so, I've found to be interesting is the idea of how in Western culture we don't have this idea of ritual for boys to become men. And I think Carl Jung would talk about that in terms of, you know, partially because of that, you know, there's this idea of the man child.
Oh, yes, there is.
Yeah. And we can tie that into patriarchy and all those things.
It opens up a lot of problems. Mm-hmm. And Campbell talked about that a lot too. He was obviously a huge fan of Carl Jung. And he's a lot of writings about that that I also found interesting.
Mm. Yeah, you'll have to send me some. I'd love to dive in
for sure.
into that further. So I guess, you know, with this new show and considering all the experiences that you've gone through in the past couple of years, how has painting transformed for you? And I also know, I mean, we've known each other for a while now, you know, and I know that you were a professor of painting, essentially, or you taught painting. And, you know, so there's a certain amount of like technical prowess that you have. But also, I mean, you know, I was listening to you on that other podcast and you're talking about how, you know, painting is not, you don't really think about it in terms of like the technical aspects of it anymore. Maybe I'm just paraphrasing that, but I guess I wanted to ask just what painting means to you now.
Man, good question. Hard to define because it has changed a lot. Like the whole experience of the last year has. It means more to me now in a broad answer to that. And it, I don't, how do I word this? Not just with me, but I think art in general. And when I look at other people's art now, I just look at it as everybody's personal experience. And I don't know if that makes any sense, because I think it would, and maybe this is just me, but like doing this as a career, as a profession, you have these goggles on when you're looking at other work of like what they did, how they did it, where's it being seen, who are they working with, how are they marketing, what's their thing selling for. It's all this stuff that really doesn't matter to me anymore. And I think it just hit on more of an emotional level and a more intuitive level. So I look at art like that, like if these are people expressing their personal experiences, and I take a greater appreciation in that. I don't like to look at things judgmentally anymore, you know?
Yeah, I understand.
It's just like, because it's a very beautiful thing to have the opportunity to do that. And I think that's how I look at like my own experience with painting now, is it's just such a great opportunity to be able to be alive and do it. And so I become less heady about it. Like I read, you know, I think it was, this is going to sound ridiculous, but I was listening to like some talk with Rick Rubin the other day. Uh-huh. I love Rick Rubin, but he was talking about like his experience with producing, if you could even call it that, is that it's an emotional thing first, and then you check it with your head, and that resonates even more. And that's, I think, how I would sum up like my experience now, is like I'm very much more into the emotional and intuitive parts of it, and then the heady part is that other side of like, okay. Because you're talking about like, you know, just make songs and don't think about where it fits yet. And you do a bunch, and then you do that curation afterwards. And that curation then is tied back into that emotional experience. You can, from another view, be like, which works more adequately represent that emotional experience I was having?
I agree. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, yeah, I think something that, I don't think this is unique to me, but you know, you listen to something or you read something, and just that thing that you read at that specific time just impacts you so heavily. So I generally go into like when I'm reading or listening to something, you know, a three month to like a year period where I just keep on thinking about it and talking about it. And one thing in particular is I read Shannon Lee's book about Bruce Lee. So Shannon Lee is, you know, his daughter, and it's called Be Water, My Friend. And there's that scene in Enter the Dragon where Bruce Lee is talking to the student, and he says, you know, he hits the student over the head and he said, "Don't think, feel."
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
And, you know, that sort of moment of philosophy that he added into that movie, I think it was very profound, and it's true. I mean, it's, you know, speaks about what you're talking about with Rick Rubin, and also, you know, just not like taking the pretentiousness out and the categorization out of artwork. I think you can appreciate something that wouldn't aesthetically resonate with you, you know, because it is really just people trying to express themselves. And I think back to looking at the artwork of children, and I bring this up a lot on the podcast, but children just express themselves, you know, and it's kind of like adults that bestow upon secondhand values onto them of what it should be or what category it should fit in. And it just doesn't matter.
Yeah. And I do think that really translates. And I know like people talk about that a lot, and maybe it sounds, I don't know, kind of silly, but you know, like for instance, I, in Paris, my two of my really, really dearest friends, there have a daughter. I don't want to put names out there just in case.
Yeah, you know, that's fine.
They don't want that, but you know, she's 12 now. And so I knew her when she was 8 is when I first met her. And like any other child, like she loves to draw, and she would always, you know, not always, but a lot frequently make me drawings. And she would do them on my phone. So I have a whole folder of her drawings on my phone. And then I actually take, cause you know, I've been moving so much in the last, I don't know how many years, I actually take her drawings with me because they're some of the most like earnest and beautiful drawings. And there was no other motivation other than to express and give it to me, which like is such a great thing. Like I would go, we always have, especially lockdown, you know, I would sneak over to their house at night because it was after curfew, and she'd be excited to give me a drawing. And it's like the most amazing thing in the world to me. And that earnestness does come true, right? There's no not a lot of pre-thought, not a lot of afterthought. It's not something that's going to be seen by a lot of people. You know, it's a one-on-one communication. So I agree. I think children's art is fantastic.
Yeah. I don't know how true this is, the statement, but because, you know, there's the aspect of commerce in it, and I'm just going to talk about the popularization of certain art forms. You know, there's definitely this idea of like who's controlling the narrative, you know? So for instance, like mainstream music, you know, there's this thing that resonates with a lot of people, right? But then there's also people like Bruce Lee, for instance, that are so true to themselves, and then it resonates with a lot of people, right? So I don't think there's any sort of equation for that. The idea of expression and how to be able, I don't know exactly what I'm trying to say here, but
with what getting into like the public consciousness.
I mean, does that even matter? I guess, you know, shouldn't you just,
I think it does to an extent, right?
It does to an extent. You're right. Yeah. Because you want people. Oh, sorry. Go on.
No. I think we're about to say the exact same thing, but I don't know if you're going to say you want people to see it, but it's a communication. It's a visual communication. Like I remember I had an instructor in school where it was a one-on-one study, and I had this whole semester of creating this body of work. And at the end of the semester, I presented it, and I was proud because it was my first cohesive body of work and this and that. And in the critique, he's like, okay, well, you're half done. And I was just thinking in terms of work making, and I was pissed. It was like, no, dude, everything's done. What are you talking about? And he's like, now you got to go get a show. And I was like, what? And he's like, yeah, you're communicating. This is visual communication. It's not there until it's put out, you know, or in essence served its function. Mm-hmm. Now, the reason you're putting out there, now that's a whole different conversation. But, you know, because like you take Bruce Lee, for example, like, yeah, he was this very, terminally individualistic in a way, right? He was like walked his own path, but he was a heavy promoter. He promoted himself and he was positioning all the time, like,
oh, for sure.
He knew what he wanted to say was important, so he had to get it out there.
Yeah,
it wasn't enough just being, you know, like a monk and doing your own thing for yourself.
Definitely. Yeah, I mean, he definitely understood the sort of narrative that needed to be put out there, you know. So there's that, and, you know, people can look to him for that sort of representation. And then you look at people like Muhammad Ali. Like recently I watched this YouTube video of Muhammad Ali, and he was on this Irish TV show getting interviewed, and just the level of understanding that he had for politics, and also, you know, the confidence that he had in his own voice. There's something interesting. I mean, there's a reason why people still talk about Muhammad Ali as well. But then I think about people like, I was watching this Philip Glass interview, and then he was talking about style. And he said on a general sense that people make a style, but, you know, if you're an artist, for instance, or, you know, he's talking about being a composer, but, you know, by the time that you're 30. And then he said the next problem is how do you break out of that?
Mm, yeah.
And then, so I've been thinking about that too, just coming to those conclusions, and I don't know.
Well, that makes me wonder too, what's the difference between voice and style? I'm really, really weary of the word style, you know, because that's a question you'll get. It's like, how do you find your style? And I think there is a difference between voice and style, because your style can slightly change, but your voice can still remain.
Of course. I guess that depends on how in touch you are with your own voice. I mean, that, you know, we're just saying words essentially, right? And like the specific word can be interpreted with a different intention and meaning, and you might have more a weight to a specific word than maybe I will, and or vice versa, right? And so it's interesting how like these things that come out of our mouth are these communication mechanisms that can be totally misconstrued. You know what I mean? I think about that a lot too, because I'm like, am I an effective communicator, or am I like, just like, I don't know, not, you know?
Yeah. No, you know, I think I'm so glad you brought that up, because that was another experience. Like, I think actually my favorite thing about living overseas was learning more about language.
Yeah.
And, you know, because I was, learning French to just try and be a good person and not be that, you know, can you please speak to me in English? Which is the funny thing because, you know, at least in Paris, you know, I think the American idea is that nobody speaks English and you have to at least try and speak French first. Some truth to this, but everybody speaks English. So it's actually easy to get by. But what was interesting to me is when trying to learn the language and then learning like just basic, like the colloquialisms, like how do people actually speak, how it's easy to misconstrue words or tone, like tone is completely different in different languages, right? Even in French. And also the effect like it had on me is getting by, because my French is so limited, is then switching to English, but I would have to simplify my English. So, because most people I knew spoke a decent amount, but I, you know, I'd have to slow down and I would have to use, like in learning French, I knew the similar words, you know, like direct translations, which were easier to use in English. Mm-hmm. So coming back, like I actually lost a lot of vocabulary and like temporarily, it took me a while to get it back, like certain words. And thinking how it affected my thinking process, because I had to think more simply about things, like how do I explain things? You know, so when I came back, I found myself always going like, ah, damn, what's that word? What's that word? And you know, be like, oh, garbage. I was like, oh, yeah, yeah, that's the word. I mean, that's a bad example. But,
yeah, no, I understand.
You know, yeah, that I think it's an I wish I had time to learn more about languages, because I think it is really fascinating, like you're saying, like how they can get misconstrued, how you can offend. There's customs and culture that goes in with these things.
Yeah, no, yeah, definitely. And also with communication, what exactly are you, I don't know. Sometimes I just think like what exactly is the person trying to communicate to me? You know, what's the subtext?
Intent.
Yeah. What's the intent? Yeah.
And I think that's great to go back into art, you know, cause that's a thing too. Like for me, like my experience just with the language thing is it made me think more about visual communication. You know, of course it's more ubiquitous, but what's the intent behind it? You know? And that's how I view a lot of work now. Whereas I didn't before. It was very much like more a surface quality or, you know, from a formal perspective. But I find myself thinking more about intention.
That's great. It makes me think about just intentionality behind, well, living, but also being able to create. And I think about that too in terms of having these conversations. It's what is the intentionality and how can you grow as like an interviewer? How can you be of service to people while not taking away from, I mean, these are just questions that I think of, you know, it's how can you be of service to people without, or like, why should you be of service to people too? Right.
Yeah, no, for sure. Yeah. A lot of things unfold, but I think, yeah. And that, you know, this kind of goes back to again, an experience for me in losing somebody, like, and plus many people in my life, it's you, and the closer they are, the more you reevaluate your life. And what I mean by that is like going into living intentionally. You know, it's very easy to let grief take over. Mm. But the flip side to these things is you realize like how wonderful and beautiful it is to be alive and to be able to do the things that we get to do, you know, anybody does, but you know, in us as creative people, you can live intentionally, right? There's living passively and there's living actively. And it's easy to live passively or without intent, I think. But we have that choice to live intentionally.
Hmm. Yeah.
And I'm really grateful for that.
That's a great thing to think about. Yeah, I mean, even that term gratitude.
I mean, bit of a buzzword. But...
But I think it's very important to be grateful for whatever that you have, the people that are in your life, and to constantly remind yourself of that. And I think, I mean, I can only speak for myself, but I need, you know, certain reminders, or I need to remind myself rather of a lot of those things as well, you know, because this life is, you know, it's kind of a balancing act, I think. Because it's like, for me at least, I don't want to be precious with everything, you know, so precious about things to where I can't let things go, you know, but I also want to be very grateful for the things I have in my life. Even this conversation, you know, I'm very grateful to have this conversation with you, and I appreciate you.
Thanks, man. Likewise.
Yeah.
No, I think it is, as much as that has become this kind of like, you know, I don't know, silly is the right word, but it's a silly buzzword, but the, you know, like anything else, there's truisms to it. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I think about that as well. Like, you know, right now I'm stressed out, you know, I had to ship this works and then I have to get all this stuff done, you know, for, to leave on Sunday. But then I'm like, man, I get to go, I'm going to Europe for however long that I want to. And then, you know, can reconnect with people out here, and this realization, like I know some really great creative people, man. That's awesome. I'm really grateful for that. And then, like you said, like I know you, known you for years, being able to have a conversation, you know, with you, like it's true. You know, take stock and take inventory of those things.
Yeah, and I think especially, you know, during times of distress or a depressive state, to be able to remind yourself that you have these things in your life and to be grateful for them. I think we all need those affirmations from time, you know?
True. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
I get mine from watching UFC. I don't know why.
Do you really?
when I'm depressed, I do. I don't know what it is, but it, yeah, for sure.
You know, I watch a lot of, yeah.
Do you still? We haven't talked about UFC in a while, but I didn't know if you're still.
Oh, I watch every fight.
Oh, awesome!
I mean, okay. Pretty much every fight. You know, if I like the
card.
Yeah. I mean, well, you know, generally I'll just watch like the main events of or the co-main events or main events of those things. But I don't know. It's an interesting thing to think about, because there's a lot of aspects about MMA that I really hate.
Such as
the promotional aspects, the idea of toxic masculinity, you know, those sort of things. But
true. Yeah, for sure.
But I think because I've been a martial artist for so long that I like to see how people do move, you know? So I kind of like, I look at it different. I think I look at it a bit differently.
Yeah. And I do agree with you, but I'm also in that mode, I think, after this last year, of not throwing out the baby with the bathwater. Because if you pull out that magnifying glass, man, and that's something I learned here being back in the Bay, is you see that a lot, is if you want to get into scrutinizing anything, you could do it.
Yeah, so, you totally could. Yeah.
Yeah.
And we're so in the age of scrutinization.
Oh, God, are we?
Exponentially. Jesus. Yeah.
So it's more about, like, I think, change than it is about, like I said, throwing out the baby with the bathwater. So yeah, those things do exist in MMA, but there's a lot of positive things that exist within it as well. You know, I've had this conversation with people here. Like, again, I find a lot of people in the Bay, it's not their thing. You know, it's just violence and this and that. But I'm like, well, it's people agreeing to push their self to the ultimate limit that I could never do. And I have an admiration for that. And it inspires me in other ways.
Yeah.
And like you said, and then the artistry to it. There's so many of those things. And I think in a way that actually goes back to, you know, like discussions with NFTs. Like we saw that in the beginning. It's like throwing out the baby with the bathwater. And I remember, remember this was the same discussion pretty much that happened with like Instagram. Is people talk about it's going to ruin art and then it's going to ruin relationships with galleries. And there's, you know, for a while it was a very like turbulent thing. But eventually what happens is integration, right? If we're smart, we find a way to integrate these things instead of throwing them out. And I feel like that's probably what will happen. You know, again, I'm a noob, but with the NFT thing, it's not going to leave. And either is crypto, as much as some people want to throw it out.
Yeah.
There's going to be, I don't think crypto should be integrated. That's a heated debate right now.
Integrated to?
Like with government.
Oh, I see.
Centralized versus decentralization. You know, a lot of discussion about that. You see China with the digital one right now. Those two, I think, are different discussions where they shouldn't be integrated. But you know, like I said, like with Instagram, you remember it was like this huge thing, and then galleries were worried because artists were going to be underselling. And eventually we found equanimity in that to an extent. It teeter-totters a little bit. But I think it's going to be the same with NFTs. Galleries are going to have to embrace it. artists are fully embracing it. And then eventually some kind of equanimity will happen.
I'm curious how, I mean, I think we were talking about this on the phone, like how the small to mid-tier galleries, how they're going to be able to adapt and exist. I mean, it's kind of hard to make that as a general statement, but, or how they'll change, you know, because I mean, I think you have more experience with working with various galleries than I do. So I'm curious what you think.
Here again, in a couple of months, I'll be proved wrong on all these things. But, I would default to just kind of like looking at what the experience of social media was. Like, I think some galleries, and I'm already starting to see this, is where maybe they'll partner with an artist. Let's say you have a show, and then you can offer the painting as an NFT and then do a digital and physical sale. So buying that NFT at a certain reserve price also gets you the painting. That's one way to do it. One is just ignoring it, which I'm sure a majority will do. But then you have to have the conversation with your artists about, you know, kind of refining your contractual obligations. For instance, you know, that happened with social media. My personal experience was having conversations with my galleries at the time and saying like, well, because usually then it was part of your contract is not to sell outside the gallery. Mm-hmm. So that changed with social media. So then let's find a happy medium. And so my experience was like under a certain price point, I'm free to do that. And then certain price points go directly with the gallery. So it's all about, I think, the conversation and finding ways to integrate. It's not going to be the same for everybody.
Yeah.
You know, some galleries are already planning NFT shows. I don't know. It's going to be interesting to see how it unfolds, but I think there's ways for everybody in it.
Yeah. I think the main thing, you know, for people that are listening to this, it's, you know, you as an artist have a lot more agency in the matter with working with galleries than you might think.
And that was kind of the experience before, right? It was a zero-sum game with a lot of artists. It's like, you know, forget the galleries. Like, that was a different conversation. Mm-hmm. That's something I don't subscribe to because it all roads and, you know, rising tide lifts all boats. Why do that? Find ways to work together in this. Or, you know, and another thing too, like I remember it was last year, almost I think to the week, where, you know, talking about opportunities with galleries and this is, I think, you know, yeah, you talked to Christopher, right? Christopher Courtney in Paris.
Oh yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
My friend Beck. Uh-huh. So we did, Chris is great, one of my closest friends, and I think a brilliant, brilliant curator and just tech guy. And we did a show at the Urban Art Fair, a VR show. So he built a VR world, and this is like straight in the VR goggles, and created this world, put the paintings in there, and we did an exhibit like that at the Urban Art Show or the Urban Art Fair. And I think he's done it with one or two other artists as well, or maybe even more than that. And, you know, for galleries, so you can do something like that. And also to benefit the galleries is you can have direct sales. You can have a button right there connected to somebody's wallet if they want to purchase a painting, and the exchange is done in crypto. And that's amazing. And I know some galleries do work with crypto already and have been for a while. But then you're opening up a broader experience. And I feel like it will lead to that because, you know, after seeing some of those and seeing what Chris has done, like, you know, the big thing during lockdown was, you know, people were calling them VR, but it was really just that like 3D experience that you can move around online.
Yeah, I know. I'm just talking about, yeah.
Yeah, which is an entirely different thing. Like, the VR is so immersive. It was so amazing that I, you know, that's another avenue I think galleries should, but probably will look at. Because, I mean, you know, they're talking the metaverse, Web 2.0. Yeah. Like, we're building the Matrix, man. So, come on. It's take the pill. Just go in.
Well, and it's also VR headsets are a lot more accessible now.
Yeah, and that's the great barrier, right, with all these things. Exactly. Is accessibility. I mean, look how the internet was before, and now it's like almost anybody can access it. We need to work on that more.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that's the only great barrier. Yeah. But it's that, and it's smart, I think, to jump on that for galleries because that's, you know, there's always the talk about targeting your future collectors, and for some reason people think it's TikTok. Mm. But it's not really, right? It's VR because that's – that's the younger generation. They're growing up with that, and that's going to be their world.
Mm-hmm.
So having them able to experience art online like that is going to be phenomenal. And you see that a lot in the NFT space. Like there's an artist I know, his name is Beats. He goes by Wide Awake Beats on Twitter, who just curated this, sorry, I try not to swear anymore, this really amazing experience, an online like virtual NFT experience. And he's doing amazing things. Like the other thing with NFTs is like, there's still, I think for a lot of us and me as well, it's like this idea of like attaching JPEG to blockchain and that's it. But with the utilization of smart contracts, you know, the things you can do are phenomenal. And one thing he did was like, you can buy this token, and if you keep it, it's a collectible NFT. But if you burn it, then it got you access into his NFT exhibit. So then you're incentivized to burn it, which then for those holding on to it actually creates scarcity and value. Like it's phenomenal the way some people are thinking right now.
I might have to bring that guy on the podcast.
You really should. I can actually, if you want, I can try and connect you with him.
Sure. Yeah, that sounds great.
Yeah, he's amazing. He's doing, and there's more people. Like I've been in a few chats and like Discords. It's phenomenal what people are coming up with.
Yeah.
And like I said, like I'm still like in the mode of like procreate, put it online, neat, you know. And then they're thinking of these things like they're writing scripts and smart contracts and like, wow, that's the thing that really, you know. And I think I said this on Sean's podcast, but like what upset me the most is when this conversation about crypto destroying the environment is, it's like, again, throwing the baby out with the bathwater. One, you're not looking to the future. Two, look at the creative avenues. And I get it, because you remember in the explosion of this, like everybody was jumping on the train to make quick money because it was during lockdown. Galleries were hurting. People were just animating paintings and putting up and selling it for a lot and whatever, do what you need to do to get through. But I think that's what it muddied the public view of the potentiality of it. Like this is a new creative outlet that expands our experience, expands what you can communicate. But also I think one of the more beautiful aspects is for most of us, it's going to instigate collaboration because we can't do all these things. We're not 3D animators. We're not musicians. So to create the bigger experience, you're going to have to collaborate. And so it's like on a smaller scale, what film is, right? To create a movie takes so many people.
Yeah.
And I think on that smaller scale, NFTs will become that as well. And there'll be a broad range, because I think also in that it creates different markets, right? Because some people are going to like the straight, just it looks like a painting, I want to buy it. And you already see that happening. And then you see this crazier digital experience that's really exciting.
That's really interesting. Making me think a lot.
Me too, man.
Have you checked out Legend Art?
That was a curated platform, right? Or they started that way?
Yeah. Their first release was with James Jean. And one of my friends, Brent Ash, is the art director or creative director for that company. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, they're working off the Wax platform, or the Wax blockchain, rather. Yeah. I think that they have a really good thing going on in terms of NFTs and the curation aspect. Maybe I'm just being biased because I like the way they curate. Yeah, I don't know.
I remember when they first dropped the platform, and it was, I think, pretty interesting. I haven't kept up with it since, because I think for me, you know what it excites me about being on the smaller platform for right now is it really, it has that DIY aspect to it. Like it reminds me, like being in terrible punk bands and trying to tour back in the day, doing everything yourself. And there's a community that gets embedded within that. And so I'm glad there's options for that.
Well, there's something beautifully naive and nostalgic, I think, about that too. You know, I kind of like the idea of being scrappy and trying to figure out how to put something together, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, and democratic, you know, it
totally,
it's open to everybody.
Totally. Yeah.
But it's good. All these things exist.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think.
No. Yeah. I agree. Well, I think you know what question's going to come up next.
I don't.
You don't? Okay. Well,
my favorite paint color.
Yeah, yeah. What's your favorite paint color? cadmium red. I'm just taking a guess.
Actually, it's Viridian.
Oh, okay. Well then, I was wrong.
Sorry.
Sorry. do you have any advice for artists and creatives?
Oh wow, that's a no. No. I don't.
No.
I mean, I don't know. It you know what, that when I hear that, it automatically just triggers like the imposter syndrome. It's like, I don't know what I'm doing, man. I'm still looking to others to figure it out.
I understand.
But you know what I mean? But and advice is weird, right? Because I think sometimes advice is what you're going through at the time. I think I've said this before. It's the only advice that's like really stuck with me through time. And again, it came from an instructor, the same one who told me I was only 50% done. is at the end of the day, art's a verb. It's just make the work. Like, don't ever lose sight of that. Hmm. You know, art is about art making. That's really stuck with me. I think you and I previously had a conversation about grit.
Yeah.
To me, that's another thing that has really stuck with me, is just stick in there and don't compare. You know, comparison's a thief of joy. That sticks with me.
Hmm.
You know, but at the end of the day, also, it's like, you know, in terms of like where I would be at now, it's like, just follow your voice and trust your intuition. To me, that's very, very important. No, don't worry. Like, an interesting thing. Sorry, easy question. I always go on tangents.
No, it's great.
The other interesting thing in being on Twitter is, you know, you have these Twitter spaces, and there's a lot of great conversations that you can listen in on about the digital world and creating NFTs. But something for me, because it's mostly what I'm guessing is a vastly younger audience, I hear a lot of things about creating your content, marketability. You know, your currency, visibility is currency, which, you know, in terms of success can be, I think, very important things. But I find those to be very dangerous concepts to cling to.
Definitely.
Because one, you're comparing to others, and what does success mean to you? But like I said, at the end of the day, it's like, make your art. You know, like I was listening to a conversation the other day of somebody asked, like, how can I get my art to stick out from others? You know, what's going to be my visual currency? And I said, well, do your own thing.
Yeah.
Like, I think, a very simple answer. Don't look to what the trend is, because the trend is going to change. And you see a lot of trend in anything, I guess, right? The art world, but NFTs especially, because it moves so quickly. And I also say that because it's something I struggle with, is like trusting my intuition, you know, and trying to do what I do and being comfortable with that.
Yeah. Yeah,
I mean, long answer to your short question. I apologize.
No, I mean, it's an open-ended question, you know. There's a lot of ways you can go about that and giving advice to people. Yeah, I mean, I think it goes back to the whole thinking and feeling thing. I think sometimes we just kind of get in our own way in a lot of ways and try to, I don't know, I'm like reiterating things, but like over-intellectualize things.
Yeah, no, I fully agree. The head often gets in the way of the heart, right?
Yeah.
They're both important. And again, I think, you know, it's just going back to that Rick Rubin thing. It's like, follow your heart and curate it with your head. Like, yeah. I'm not saying like that marketability, of course, those things are important if you're trying to make your living as an artist, but put the cart before the horse and curate with the head and lead with your instinct.
Yeah. I like that. Thanks for doing this, man. I appreciate
you. No, thank you.
Yeah. I appreciate you for taking this time.
It was all my pleasure, man. I really appreciate you taking the time. I hope it was informative or interesting.
Of course. Yeah. No, this is a great conversation.
I thought so, man. It was great to talk to you.
Yeah. Yeah. You too. So can you remind people of where they can see your show and the date?
Onto the marketability aspect of things.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
As I contradict myself, let me tell you.
Yeah.
My new show, it's Liminal Spaces. It opens Thursday, November 4th is the opening. It's Stolen Space Gallery in London. And then I'm Yeah, I'm leaving this weekend and traveling around Europe. So I'll be doing some stuff in Paris. Like I'm doing a couple murals.
Oh, cool, man.
And then, nice. And then an event at, because I'm working with an independent curator. And so there's a place called Fluxuart. It's really amazing. It's kind of this, it's on a boat on the Seine. It's like a street art museum / bar. And I'm going to be painting there like November 21st. And see what happens after that.
Nice.
I'm on my Forrest Gump tour.
You're going to run around Europe?
I'm just going to keep on running, yeah. Jenny.
he's gonna swim across the Atlantic.
Who knows, man? I'm into trying new things.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, like I said, I've been doing the NFT things, so I'm on Twitter and all that stuff now.
Cool. Awesome, man. All right, well, thanks. Thanks for doing this.
My pleasure. Great to talk to you, Yoshino.
Yeah, you too, man. Talk to you later.
All right, take care.
Music for the podcast is by Rarebit, a.k.a. Justin Dosher Hopkins. Creative producer is Noah Wainwright. YouTube and creative support is by Tyler Scully. Thanks so much for tuning in. See you next time.